Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Everybody, this is the continuation of the November 16th, 2020 Board of Commissioners meeting. That meeting was recessed as planned. Now, because of a technicality regarding a couple of public hearings that were scheduled, it is now 10 o'clock in the morning on Wednesday, November 18th. This meeting is all virtual. We have three commissioners attending via Zoom and two commissioners who are participating by telephone. We're going to begin the meeting with a roll call. I'm Chair Amy Scott Daly, and understand with us today we have Vice Chair Stephen Carter.
Here.
And Commissioner Eddie Bossel.
Here.
Commissioner Bill Lashley.
Here.
And Commissioner Tim Sutton.
Present.
Great. Thank you very much. So this is actually for the public. This is the first time that the Alamance County Board of Commissioners has ever met in an all virtual format. All through the virus, we've managed to continue to do the work of the county while having commissioners present in person to convene the meeting and having some participate virtually and staying compliant with the executive order's limits on the number of people present. But for other circumstances, we had to have this meeting all virtually today. So bear with us, please, if we have any glitches or wrinkles to iron out through the process. And commissioners, it's worth noting at the beginning of the meeting that all the votes have to be done by roll call. So when I call for a vote, I will go down the list and then I will announce the results of the vote and the number voting in the affirmative and the number voting in the negative. Does anybody have any questions before we get started with the agenda about the virtual meeting or what's required of us? Okay, if not, then we will resume with the meeting. The agenda has also, for this recess meeting, has been published. And the first item on it is to consider approval of the economic incentive grant agreement for Chick-fil-A, which we had the public hearing the other day, Monday night, and the meeting was recessed so that we could have 24 hours more for public comment. Madam Clerk, has there been any additional public comment received regarding the economic incentive for Chick-fil-A?
No, Madam Chair.
Okay, thank you. So there having been no additional public comment offered on the matter, Mr. Albright, County Attorney, is the matter appropriate for a final vote at this time?
It is.
All right, so we would be entertaining the motion if anybody wants to make one.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion to approve. And when you make the motion, gentlemen, if you could state your name when you make the motion and or second. So the motion to approve was made by Vice Chair Carter. Is that right?
Second.
That's correct.
Seconded by Commissioner Boswell.
And the second is by Commissioner Boswell. So the motion and second to approve the economic incentive agreement with Chick-fil-A. Is there any further discussion? If there's no discussion, I will go through the roll call. Vice Chair Carter?
Yes.
Commissioner Boswell?
Yes.
Commissioner Lashley?
Yes.
Commissioner Sutton?
No.
And the chair votes in the affirmative. Therefore, the motion carries 4-1. Four commissioners voting in the affirmative and one voting in the negative. All right, let's go on to the next item is the land development plan update. It was offered for approval, and we had a public hearing about it Monday night, which was recessed for a 24-hour comment period by the public. Madam Clerk, have we received any additional public comments related to land development plan?
Yes, Madam Chair, we have received written comments.
If you could go ahead and read those, indicating the person's name and maybe spelling their name for the press, and make their job a little easier. And you start that when you're ready.
Okay. As residents of Snow Camp, our concern is with the preservation of our community. We chose Snow Camp to retire along with others based on the open areas and respect shown to the natural environment. We support option A to enhance protection from any further heavy industry encroaching on our community. Thank you for your time and consideration in addressing our concerns and comments. Dr. Timothy J. Mulrooney, Mulrooney. Next, I am a resident of Snow Camp, and I am writing to express my support for the small area plan for Snow Camp with option A within 6 months. Please take appropriate action to implement this measure to protect and preserve our community. Thank you and kind regards, Jennifer Spinhoven, Spinhoven. Okay. My name is Deborah Sanders. I am a landowner in Alamance County, specifically the Snow Camp Road and Clark Road area. I'm not one to protest or make waves. Notice the time of this email. I went to bed three times tonight, but decided I had to get up and fight for our community. I'm retired and just wanted to move back home to be near my family. I've owned a decent amount of land here since 1977. I could care less if the person living next to me has cows, pigs, horses, or carrier pigeons. I don't care if they are Asian, Hispanic, Black, or from Ireland. I do care about silica dust from a quarry and explosions from a gas pipeline and noise out my back door. I could have moved to the city for two out of three of those worries. I was determined not to write or call in on this county land development plan, but after listening to what Mr. Cobb said, it occurred to me that he, for one, has absolutely no clue what folks in Snow Camp have been fighting since 2018. Mr. Cobb is in business to put in septic tanks to build communities, so therefore he would like the entire county zoned at one time. That could take up to 2 years, and that could also cripple the Snow Camp community. I would like to request that the commissioners, that the people of this county vote into office, please listen to the people and go with small area plan option A. I feel that this plan might not stop what we are going through, but it will give the land development people a look at what is ahead and what problems they will better be equipped to handle for the different sections of the county. From the looks of things, the southeast section of the county is farm and acreage. I, for one, would like to keep it that way. I came here to retire and sit on the front porch and watch cows, not smokestacks or smell chemicals. Thank you for your time. Deborah Sanders, S-A-N-D-E-R-S. Okay. To the Board of Commissioners for Alamance County, my name is Stephanie Thurman, and I support the proposed small area plan for Snow Camp, specifically option A, protection within 6 months, versus option B, countywide zoning, which could take 2+ years. I am grateful for whatever you can do to make this happen, because we need this protection from heavy industry sooner rather than later. Thank you. And again, that was Stephanie Thurman, T-H-U-R-M-A-N. And that is all of the additional comments we received, Madam Chair.
Great, thank you very much. Based on the comments received, is there any further discussion from the commissioners? Okay, I don't hear anybody piping up, so I'll assume that's a no. I do want to make one response to somebody mentioned Mr. Cobb and his involvement as a member of the planning board and suggested that he might have a personal reason for wanting countywide zoning. I've observed Mr. Cobb and his work on the planning board being the commissioner representative to that board, and I'm sure that he's motivated by a civic spirit and the desire to serve the community and not by any kind of personal gain or personal factors. He's worked really hard for a long time as a planning board member. And I just wanted to mention that. I can understand maybe why somebody who doesn't know him, a member of the public, just as somebody coming into it just for out of interest for this one particular issue might have a question, but having observed him over the past few years and his work on the planning board, I'm sure that he's not motivated by personal gain in his thoughts about the development in the county. Does anybody else have anything they want to say?
Amy, I agree with you on that. I've known Ray a long time, and I know he's got the best interest of the county at heart. So I thank you for pointing that out, though.
He's sure does. He's a fine man. So, if anybody wants to make a motion, it's the time to do it.
Motion to approve.
Second. Second, Bill Ashley.
Okay. Vice Chair Carter has made a motion to approve the land development plan under the same motion which was offered on Monday night. And Commissioner Lashley has offered a second to that. Is there any more discussion?
Amy,
yes,
point of order, did we not need to open public comments again? I'm not sure.
Wow, that's a really good question. That is a good question. Mr. Albright, should we have voted to open and close the public hearing again?
No, you don't have to. The statute provides that written comments may be submitted in the 24-hour period after your initial vote.
Okay, great. So the motion that Mr. Carter has made is timely?
It is.
Okay. Thank you for bringing that up. That was a really good question. So I'll go through the roll call. Vice Chair Carter?
Yes.
Commissioner Boswell?
Yes.
Commissioner Lashley?
Yes.
Commissioner Sutton?
Yes.
And I vote yes as well. So the motion carries 5-0 unanimously. Okay, moving along to our unresolved business from Monday night. The next item on the agenda is the Coronavirus Relief Funds Action Plan as revised November 2020. And I believe that County Manager Hager is going to present that item.
Thank you, Chair Gailey. Can everyone hear me okay?
Yes.
All right. So bear with me as I share my screen and pull up the presentation I'm going to go through with you. There we go. Now, I hope everyone can see the presentation. It's on the screen before the commissioners that are on the Zoom call, and then I did email this information to all the commissioners. So Commissioner Sutton and Commissioner Boswell, you should have an email from me that includes a PDF titled Coronavirus Relief Fund Action Plan Update. So if you'd like to, if you're not able to see this via the Zoom call, you can follow along with that PDF as I go. And commissioners, as I go over this information, if you have any questions, please just jump right in and I'll stop where we're at and we'll go over your questions. So I'm going to go ahead and get started. You know, we've spent since March learning a lot about COVID-19, how it's affecting our community, how the county government and our municipal partners best respond. We've kind of been planning and funding as we go, and we've learned a great deal. And you know, it has been extremely helpful to have these funds that we received, that are federal funds that flowed through the state. They made it possible for us to meet a lot of these expenses, these unknown expenses, and use those federal/state funding. We received, as you can see on the screen, almost $6.3 million worth of coronavirus relief funds, CRF, coronavirus relief. And those are federal dollars that have passed through the state, and the state has created a new agency, if you'll recall, the North Carolina Pandemic Relief Office, NCPRO. NCPRO has been working with all the local governments across the state to help properly administer these funds. The funds were given to the cities and counties to be used for coronavirus response and mitigation efforts. And back in September, we submitted a plan to NCPRO. That was our action plan, what we thought at the time we were going to be doing with the CRF monies that we had received. And we've been working very closely with NCPRO as we go, making sure if we're planning on spending CRF dollars, is it compliant? I will say the state has continuously added requirements and restrictions, as we kind of knew it would happen when these funds first came. It was pretty wide open, right? As time has gone by, the state has added more and more level of requirements and restrictions on how they can be used. But we've been working closely with NCPRO. We're required to send a new update to NCPRO this month. We have included in your packet a new coronavirus relief action plan. You can see it in the agenda packet. It's on the state forms that they require us to use. And that new action plan reflects what we're going to show NCPRO we are doing and have done with the almost $6.3 million in funding that we've received. The CRF funding expires December 30th of this year. That means any funding that we have not spent or have allocated to spend by December 30th has to be returned to the state. And we have an action plan that allocates all of those dollars between now and December 30th. And I'm going to go over that with you. But we have two versions of this plan. It's concerning to us that the CRF dollars have to be spent or allocated by December 30th, because we know that COVID and the COVID-related response is going to continue on into next calendar year. There's no question about that. So we have come up with a plan. We're giving NCPRO, and you have in your packet, how we are spending the funds up till December 30th, and then we do have a post-December 30th action plan that I'll go over with you at this in this PowerPoint. So in your packet, you can see we have a CRF action plan that we'll send down to the state. This is how we are indicating to the state NCPRO office we are allocating out the $6.3 million. We're allocating almost $3 million of it to public health and safety salaries. This is acceptable to NCPRO and to the state to use CRF dollars to cover salaries of eligible public health and safety employees. This is very important, and I'm going to talk a lot about this $2.9 million, because what that does, it allows us to use some county dollars to continue the NCPRO mitigation after December 30th. So almost $3 million of our $6.2 to cover public health and safety salaries. We're currently planning to spend a little over $960,000 in hazard pay. Remember, we've already done one hazard pay bonus back, I believe it was in May. We'll be talking here in a moment about another possible one that we could do. We've also indicated the state we're going to spend over $770,000 in compliance public health measures. Those include things like cleaning, the PPE that we've had to purchase, and new cleaning contracts that we've had to sign. And then of our $6.23 million, we were required to give $1.5 million of it to our municipal partners. So you remember a number of meetings ago, we approved a budget that gave the $1.5 million out to almost all of our cities. I think we had two that didn't really feel like they had a coronavirus plan, so those dollars were given out to the rest of the cities and towns. So really, for this item on the agenda, we're asking for the commissioners to approve the CRF action plan that is in your packet. That is what we will send to the state. What you see on this slide is how the dollars are broken up and that we will demonstrate to the state of North Carolina. I'm going to talk now, if you don't have questions about this, I'm going to talk a little bit about what this allows us to plan for and pay for to continue to deal with COVID in our community after December 30th. And we have a few other items on the agenda that we'll talk about as we get through this one that are directly affected. So I'm going to go on to the next slide. So I told you that funding for the public health and safety salaries was extremely important. You can see that what we are going to do is use county dollars after December 30th to pay for these ongoing COVID-related costs. And the $2.9 million in CRF money allows us to do that if we use it to offset public health and safety salaries. One thing you will notice immediately, on this slide, it's $2.9 million for public health and safety. On this slide, I'm only showing you how we're allocating $2.7. The reason is, if you recall, we did our $200,000 small business loan program back several months ago. It was going to be so difficult to do that with NC Pro money through their requirements that we opted to use county dollars and offset it with public health and safety salaries. So we've already taken $200,000 out because that program is well underway. As you heard, our meeting before last has been successful, and it's helping local business. So we've already allocated that $200,000. This is what we're planning to do with the remainder of the $2.7 million. So we've been working closely with the court and the detention center to make sure that the court system stays clean and they get plenty of PPE. We budgeted over $88,000 to continue to do that. Our detention center, if you'll recall, after we had our outbreak, we have spent money to prevent that outbreak, and we've also earmarked funds in the event, heaven forbid, that there is another outbreak, that we have the dollars that we need in place, ready to start testing or whatever else we need to do if there's another outbreak at the detention center. We've also budgeted some of this $2.7 million after December 30th to be used for compensation response. Some of that, you'll hear about $200,000 that is for this possible round of hazard pay that we'll talk about in a moment. The rest of it is being used for things like emergency FMLA payout. We have employees that go out either quarantined or isolated. This helps continue to pay them. We budgeted over $156,000 for teleworking. We've sent a lot of employees home trying to work on social distancing and to increase our public billing technology to allow for more virtual access to both court and county buildings. We're planning for over $40,000 worth of continued sanitizing and cleaning after December 30th. We're also looking at almost $75,000 worth of communication and infrastructure updates that will continue after the December 30th CRF deadline. Then we have included a safe distancing category of this $2.7 million that comes to a little over $146,000. This includes the Medicaid lease renewal and the EM Frank Holt Drive lease that we'll be talking about in a moment. But these funds, I'm proposing to use this $2.7 million to pay for those costs. And then we've also included in plans for post-December 30th, if the commissioners are interested, and if our small businesses in our community continue to need assistance from the county, we could do another round of our small business loan program. We currently figured that at $200,000. Obviously, that would be up to the commissioners to approve. So for post-December 30th COVID-related spending, we believe that if things hold the way that they are going now, we'll spend another $1.3 million of that $2.7 on what we believe we know will happen starting January 1 through the end of the fiscal year. That leaves $1,413,274 of county dollars that will be slated for COVID response, all part of this 2.7, that currently don't have an allocation. We would hold those funds in case some of these costs balloon or we have some kind of a new COVID-related problem. You know, we're getting ready to get into the vaccination piece of COVID. We don't know what all those costs will be. I would suggest keeping that $1.4 million available for whatever might come along after December 30th related to COVID would be a good idea. So for this act, this item on the agenda, what we are asking for is the commissioners to approve the new CRM action plan that's in your packet that shows the state how we're going to spend the dollars per their compliance regulations. And then we're going to move through the rest of the agenda. The next four items are all related to post December 30th COVID response that uses this $2.7 million in funding that will be freed up of county dollars that we're able to use a little easier. So I hope I made that clear. And if anyone has any questions, we got a number of county staff working on COVID response, particularly from the financial perspective, and those folks are on this call too. So if you have questions that I can't answer, I'll be looking to them to help us too. So.
Brian, this is Commissioner Boswell. I noticed on the news today they're talking about using the Paramount Theater down in Burlington as a court for jury trials. Are you familiar with that?
Yes, the court was shut down for a while and early on in the pandemic, and anytime you close the court, you start running into these terrible scheduling problems because they have work scheduled out for months. So they are very sensitive to making sure they don't close. I called with Hardin Watkins, city manager over at Burlington, and I know that the Superior Court judge has called with the city too, and felt like if Paramount Theater could be used, the court staff and some of our county folks have gone over and visited it. It appears that with very little work, it could be used for jury trials, which is good news in case we have any kind of a problem in the current court building. So we were glad the city was willing to work with us in the court system to try to make that happen.
Well, with that happening, what about the security? I know we got to have security in our court systems. Would Burlington Police assume that responsibility since it's, out of the county's overseen, or how is that going?
I think we have planned to accommodate those costs in this $1.3 million as far as, we're doing the COVID screening for folks that are going into the courts, and then we would include any new contract cleaning that the Paramount would require would be part of these dollars, as well as any PPE, specifically like the separators, plexiglass, all that would be included in here. I'm not sure off the top of my head if it would be the Sheriff's Department or Burlington Police that would be providing the security. I am sure the Sheriff's Office would have staff in there because they're already so used to working with the judges and the clerks that there would be some level of Sheriff's Department representation, but it might also take some additional assistance from Burlington Police.
Okay, I was just curious about that part of it. Thank you.
Traditionally, court security is the job of the Sheriff's Office in the county, so.
Indeed.
Do you need a motion?
Yes, we do.
I'll make the motion and we approve.
I'll second it, Steve Carter.
Motion. Bill Lashley.
Okay, so we have a motion to by Commissioner Lashley to approve the CRF action plan, and a second by Commissioner Carter. Is there any more discussion or questions? I'd just like to take a second to say that I think this is a really good plan, especially in how it accounts for future waves of the virus and how that might affect the detention center. I think it's very wise to plan for the future and not get caught with a lot of expenses next year and then trying to figure out things after the fact and having to sacrifice maybe other county priorities. And that's what this money was designed for by Congress. I also wanted to take a note to say that I'm very pleased with how I've observed the county has worked with our local court system in cleaning the facilities and making sure that the courts had the things that they needed in order to be able to operate safely. And my travels around the state virtually over the past several months have caught wind that other counties aren't so well suited as ours. There's been a lot of friction about who's going to pay the cost of keeping the court system clean, and how how that is going to go forward with keeping the courts open as much as possible. And I'm really proud of how our county staff have worked with our local courts to kind of have this kind of conflict arise. So does anybody else have any comments or anything they need to say?
Amy, I guess this motion does include the small business loan program with $200,000 into it. Is that what we're voting to do?
This is to approve the CRF action plan that, yes, I believe it did include that. Is that right, Brian?
The budget amendment at the end, the final item on the agenda that's involving COVID, the budget amendment, will set all these funds in place, but we would come back to the commissioners to ask for funding, additional funding for the small business plan to be approved. So I don't think we've spent all of it yet. We're getting very close, and we want an opportunity to evaluate the program at the end, the current program, make sure everybody's pleased with it. So this action you're taking will help put those dollars in place, but we want this won't specifically approve doing the plan, doing the loan again. I'll be back before the commissioners in the next couple of months making that presentation.
Well, we three of us won't be there in a couple months, so I hope you continue on. I think that's a great program, and people really are struggling right now, so good job.
Four.
All right, so we have a motion by Mr. Lashley and a second by Mr. Carter to approve the CRF action plan. I'm going to call for the vote. Vice Chair Carter?
Yes.
Commissioner Boswell?
Yes.
Commissioner Lashley?
Yes.
Commissioner Sutton?
Yes.
And I, Amy Daly, vote yes. So the motion carries 5-0. All right, the next item is consideration of approval of hazard pay.
Very well, I'm going to stop sharing my screen and go back to share again, and then I'm going to pull up the hazard pay PowerPoint, see if I can put it on the screen for everyone. I hope everybody can see. Okay, so this is another piece of our COVID response. If the commissioners will recall, I believe I'm correct in saying it was in May that we did a first round of hazard pay for our first responders and a number of county employees, and particularly DSS and the health departments that have been very much on the front line dealing with individuals that have COVID, having to go in some precarious situations, putting themselves at risk. We established criteria when we did the first round that helped us. It's been difficult, frankly, selecting county employees that to build a criteria to qualify for this hazard pay bonus, because we very much appreciate all the work that all the county employees have done across the board. Our county departments are open today and dealing with individuals. But we felt like when we did our first round that these individuals that I'll show you in a moment were particularly at risk. They're either first responders of various types or employees who are finding their jobs, putting them in significant risk, or working areas that put them in direct contact with folks with COVID-19. So we've limited it to that original criteria. We haven't changed any of the criteria from the first round of hazard pay bonuses. And at that time, we reviewed that with our department heads, our human resources department, and myself. So this slide gives you an idea of the departments that would be involved with a hazard pay bonus. That would be our public health department. And we worked with health last time, and we've kept the criteria the same. We believe there are two different tiers of individuals at health. And you see the dollar amount that would be the bonus, same dollar amount last time. Also with our EMS department, we have different bonus dollar amounts for full-time and part-time employees. It's the same thing for emergency management and CCOM. We have our fire marshal department, again, with their full-time employees. DSS had two tier levels of employees they felt like were at One is tier two, you see the dollar amounts there. And one thing that is different with this round of hazard pay bonus potential as opposed to last time, the sheriff's department paid for their own bonuses for hazard pay from their budget. They did that because at the time when we were contemplating hazard pay for employees, we were not under a requirement to give funding to the municipalities, and we wanted to be fair. We wanted to really focus on, okay, what were strictly county government level functions that were putting themselves at risk. And we knew our municipal partners had law enforcement too, but the sheriff felt like his folks in both detention and patrol and his employees were at risk, so he funded his bonuses himself out of his own budget. This time, because we have funded the municipalities, they have their own dollars, they can make their decision whether or not they want to do hazard pay at all, and if they do, would they want to include their law enforcement. We put the sheriff's office staff in with the rest of the county employees to be paid for with a combination of CRF funds and our post December 30th money. So this slide will show you, we have 555 total employees that come from these seven departments, all sheriff's office and detention full-time staff, all EMS, CCOM, and emergency management full and part-time staff, DSS, the folks at DSS that are included in this proposed hazard pay bonus are their adult protective service, child protective service, and their foster care social workers that are going out. And our health department has identified employees by the work assigned. It's their nurses, and then they have employees that have been pulled out of their normal jobs to try to help with COVID mitigation. So we have folks that are doing food deliveries to people's houses that have been tested positive. If they can't get out, have no one that can help them get supplies. So health has identified people, same criteria as the first round. The total cost of this hazard pay bonus program is $867,501. I would propose that we take $639,848 of that amount from the coronavirus relief funding. That's in the action plan you just approved. So since the last time we did hazard pay bonus, since May, NC Pro has put new requirements on the pot. You can do hazard pay bonuses, but they have changed. Well, originally they had no requirements. Now they have initiated requirements. The requirements that NC Pro has put in place mean that we can only pay $639,848 from CRF monies. We're going to use our post-December 30th funding from that $2.7 million that we were just talking about to the tune of $227,652.38, because we felt like we really wanted to keep our local criteria the same. So in order for us to keep the local criteria the same as the first round, which we felt like those were appropriate employees, we have to use a combination of CRF funds and our post-December 30th coronavirus response fund. So if the board approves this, this PowerPoint was prepared for Monday night, so obviously we won't have checks out November 18th, because I think we are November 18th. If the board approves this today, though, we will be able to have the hazard pay checks out very quickly to these eligible employees. I believe that is my final slide on this topic. So if you have questions, I'll be happy to try to answer it. Again, we have Sherry on here from HR, and I know she can chime in if you have specific human resource related questions. And we are asking for the approval from the board to proceed with this bonus.
I'll move.
This is Commissioner Boswell. I will make a motion to that.
Okay, Commissioner Boswell, I think Mr. Lashley beat you to it. So Commissioner Lashley made a motion to approve. Would you like to second it?
I will second that, yes.
Okay, great. Thank you, Commissioner Boswell. So we have a motion by Mr. Lashley to approve the hazard pay as presented and seconded by Commissioner Boswell. Are there any questions or comments?
I think it looks like a good plan. We've got a lot of people working really hard to keep our community safe and taking a lot of risk when they do it personally as well. So which we can do more.
Indeed. All right, Vice Chair Carter, how do you vote?
Yes.
Mr. Boswell?
Yes.
Mr. Lashley?
Yes.
Mr. Sutton?
Yes.
And I vote yes as well, Chair Daly. So that is 5-0 in the affirmative, and the motion passes. The next item on the agenda is the Hardin Street facility lease renewal.
Okay, Commissioners, I'm going to bring up the next PowerPoint. Okay, everyone can see? Okay. All right, so Commissioners, if you recall, as part of our COVID response, first of August, we leased property over at 378 Hardin Street. This is the former Medi-Cap pharmacy facility over right at the edge of Burlington and Graham. We leased that property primarily for the tax department to use at the time as a satellite drive-through that we were getting into receiving our tax payments, our property tax payments. And ordinarily, we have a tremendous number of people that come into county office building to make their payments in person. We felt like leasing this space for a satellite drive-through made sense. It kept the citizens safe in their cars, separated from county staff. It also kept our staff safe. We have a lease in place that expires January 31st of 2021. Our current lease payment is $6,092 per month. PACS has had significant success using this site as a satellite drive-through. My understanding is since this began, which I believe was in August, we've had over 1,800 vehicles come through our drive-through window, which is a lot of people coming through that have been able to avoid having to come in person in the county office building. So it's good news. So at this time, right now, we're using CRF funds to pay this lease until December 30, when the CRF funding runs out. So you have in your packet a proposal to extend the lease of the Hardin Street former Medi-Cap property for another 6 months. The lease payments would remain the same, and the new lease would expire July 31st. We'll continue to use CRF funds to pay the lease through the end of the calendar year, and then we'll go back to the plan that we've made for the $2.7 million of what I'm calling COVID-19 response funds to pay the remainder of the lease until it expires July 31st. So again, this is part of our COVID response plan, making use of this property. We have begun examining this property for what long-term fit it might have in our county facility plan. It's an excellent building. It's in very good shape, conveniently located, has very good parking, both disabled and other parking. Now, I know Jeremy is on this call, and he may be able to speak to the value the tax has seen from the satellite drive-through. But I think in between now and July, the commissioners will hear more from me about what we might be able to do with this building going out past the expiration of the new lease. But the request today is to extend the lease for another 6 months until July 31st and use our identified COVID-19 response funds to pay that bill. So, and I'll take any questions. And again, Jeremy may be able to chime in about the value too.
I have a question. This is Sutton. Has that property been appraised?
Yes, it has.
What's the figure?
I don't have that in front of me, but we have had a analysis of the building systems, roof, HVAC, wiring, plumbing done, just kind of checking it out. I will have to get that dollar figure to the commissioners. If it's okay with the commissioners, I will send that to you as soon as the meeting's over. I don't want to quote anything and not be accurate, but we do have an appraisal, so I'll send it to you after the meeting if that's okay.
Thank you.
Brian, yes. Commissioner Boswell, what have we spent in upfitting the building for our purposes? Do you know that number?
Sherry, are you able to comment on that any? I know we have done some upfit. We had to get some work done to the drive-in window space and then get county internet run over there so that the tax employees could use the current system. I think Sherry is still on the call. Sherry, are you able to give any estimate for that?
I don't have the exact number for that, but most of the work was done by our maintenance department, so I believe the upfitting was much less than $10,000.
Okay, that's great. Thank you.
I have one more question. This is Tim. And I should know this maybe, but is that just a drive-through access, or is it walk-in as well or not?
So the building does have walk-in access. It's still inside like a pharmacy. It's got some large common areas, the drive-in window, a number of offices, rooms, storage areas. So it was originally designed, of course, for people to come in and do their shopping or come through the drive-through and pick up their prescriptions primarily. So it is able to be accessed. And again, this is why I think the commissioners may hear more about this building and some thoughts about what we might do with it as we get closer to July 31st, because one of the things it has going for it, from our perspective, it has excellent parking, excellent disabled parking, because it's so new. The building is fairly new, so it's, you know, many of our county buildings constructed in the 70s when the ADA requirements weren't quite so stringent as they are with new construction. So it's a good space. It checks out very well and has been useful, I think, for tax and for the citizens.
And for clarification, the way the tax is using it right now is purely for drive-through. Because I'm not sure exactly which question you're asking. We're using it purely for drive-through. But it's excellently set up for walk-in. If you wanted to do walk-in there, it is well suited for that.
Well, my question, I've been in the building many times. My question would be security right off the interstate. Not that I would be against the building, but, and I'll be gone anyway. But, you know, off the interstate, it's like a branch bank just sitting there. And I would be worried about security to some degree. But with that said, I'll go on.
I will contribute that the Sheriff's Department has just been excellent in having deputies posted over there. Most of the time we've got security presence, because obviously we're handling money, and that's just with having the tax satellite. So I don't know if that will be a consideration as well, but the Sheriff's Department has done an excellent job.
Madam Chair, Commissioner Boswell, I would like to go ahead and make a motion to extend this lease on the Hardin Street building.
Thank you.
This is Bill Knight. I'll second the A card.
Okay, we have a motion by Mr. Boswell to approve the lease renewal and second by Mr. Lashley. No more discussion, I'll call the roll. Vice Chair Carter?
Yes.
Commissioner Boswell?
Yes.
Commissioner Lashley?
Yes.
Commissioner Sutton?
Yes.
And I, Chair Daly, vote in the affirmative as well. So the motion carries 5-0 unanimously. All right, the next item on the agenda is the Emergency Management Equipment Facility.
Very well, Commissioners. We're going to the last PowerPoint that I have.
Yay!
Indeed. Last one. So we're going to talk a little bit about the plan we have. This is part, again, more of our COVID response, although this does help us with a problem that we currently have even before COVID. But so we currently lease space over at 108 Electric Avenue. This is over near the former Bird Tractor. It's a former bird tractor property over off of Maple, Maple Avenue in Burlington. We lease 5,000 square feet of space there to store emergency management equipment. So we've got 19 pieces of equipment in that space now, and those range from several vehicles. MC1, our large mobile command post, as well as a number of emergency management trailers, all kinds of equipment. And we've actually got two pieces of equipment that are en route that we've been approved to receive, a new animal shelter trailer that we would use in the event of inclement weather, or if we have to shelter people and they bring their pets. We also have, I believe it was our, we're hoping to get this mobile vaccination trailer through our CDBG grant. So we're already busting out at the seams at the site that we're currently in. The lease payment at the property where we are now with Ian's equipment is $1,300 a month. We've gotten an excellent deal for the past 2 to 3 years from the property under there. Our lease doesn't expire until next September. However, we're already out of space there now, and there is no space in that current building for us to do any COVID-related issues. And the COVID-related things that we see coming are storage of additional PPE. We're currently storing PPE in several different places, our sanitizing materials, and we know that the vaccination program is coming. I think everyone is glad to hear that. We're all anxiously looking forward to mass vaccination of our community. But we don't know exactly what that's going to entail, and from what I understand, the health department will be the way that those vaccines will get out into the county, to the community. So what we're proposing to do is lease warehouse space, new warehouse space located at 1813 Frank Holt Drive. It's a little over 15,000 square feet. It includes five bays that are tall enough we can get all of our equipment in and out of the bays. This facility has a loading dock where a tractor trailer can pull up and be unloaded, or a box truck. Property is heated. A lot of this equipment that's EMS has to be climate controlled. The lot is fenced. We would, if we do lease this property, we would move all of emergency management's equipment over there and be able to take in the new equipment that's coming. This would also allow for room for storing all the PPE that we have, the sanitizing materials that we're going to get, as well as whatever is going to need to be done to get vaccines out into our community. This property would help meet that need. And it does have space where if we have COVID response teams through the health department that need to get together and do things, whatever that might be involving this vaccination equipment, this facility would host that. We also believe that there would be room here for the sheriff's office. They have some equipment that they have stored in various areas around the county that we could consolidate here. And our new mobile library, which Susanna tells me is being prepped and put together and should be here in a couple of months, this facility would be able to put it there too. And our new mobile vaccination trailer, if we get that, this would be the location for it. So the lease of this space is $8,098 per month. That's a little over $97,000 a year, and it would be a five-year lease. The lease would begin January 1st. We would use COVID-19 response funds. This is we have budgeted part of that $2.7 million to pay for this through July 1st of 2021. Then what would we do after July 1st? We would either use additional COVID-19 response funds. If you'll recall, we thought there would be around $1.4 million that we don't have a specific COVID-related purpose for. We could use those funds to continue to pay the lease. We might be able to use some of our planned $1.3 million worth of COVID money if things don't happen, like I hope we don't have another outbreak in the jail. If we don't, we may be able to use some of those funds to pay for this lease. We've also started the conversation with the local emergency planning commission. They had designated funds to help us find a new facility for this equipment storage. We may be able to use some of those. Worst case scenario, this is the one that I would want to avoid at all possible costs, would be using new county revenue starting in next year's budget. I think that we can avoid doing that by using COVID-19 response funds and maybe some LAPC funds if LAPC improves. But it is important to understand this is more money than we're currently paid, but it is much more facility than we currently have. We do have some concerns about being able to renew our current lease in September. The property owner has been excellent, great to work with, but when we renewed last time, there was some discussion about they may have a need for the space that we're in, because it's actually, the space we're in currently over off of Maple Avenue is part of a business property that they're using. They have a successful business and they may need it. So this would help us with an existing problem, and it would, I believe, put us in a place to deal very well with the COVID response, particularly from a mass vaccination and PPE storage. One thing to think about too is if we get into this lease, if you approve this lease today, we get into the lease, 2 years from now, we're wanting to relocate from this, or we're going out of this property, we would be in the lease. We would have to continue the lease because there's a real market for this kind of property. We've had a difficult time finding a piece of a facility like this. But if we had to, we could sublet it. The lease does allow for subleasing, so we would be able to sublet it. So that might help us. That is not the plan, but if something happened and we were going out of it, we would look at that option. So I hope that kind of gives you an idea of what this is about, and we do need a motion if we're going to enter into this lease agreement.
Bill Lansky, I'll make a motion.
I'll second that, Commissioner Boswell.
Okay, we have a motion by Mr. Lashley and a second by Commissioner Boswell to approve the equipment facility lease for emergency management. Is there any discussion or question? If not, I'll call the roll. Vice Chair Carter?
Yes.
Commissioner Boswell?
Yes.
Commissioner Lashley?
Yes.
Commissioner Sutton?
Yes.
And Chair Daly votes yes as well. The motion carries 5-2-9. I have a quick question, Mr. Albright.
He just stepped out for a moment.
He stepped out?
He stepped out just for a moment.
Question, Mr. Sutton, you indicated before we started the meeting, you let me know that you needed to leave the meeting at 11. Is that still true?
Yes, I was getting ready to say that. I was going to say what the next item was, but I do have to leave. I have an appointment, and I'm going to wish everybody a happy Thanksgiving.
Right. I wanted to get Mr. Albright's input on that and verify that we still have a quorum if you leave. I know that, you know, three are required for a quorum, but I'm not 100% convinced that that still holds up in the virtual meeting, so... while we wait for Mr. Albright to come back, how about Andrea Rollins? Do you want to go ahead and start with the budget amendment for the TRF grant?
Yes, I can. The last step in this approval process of the entire plan included all of these items, and the next step is to update the budget in the accounting system. NCPR required us to account for our former funds separately from our general fund. So you'll see two sections on this budget amendment, but we're matching the accounting record to the plan that we sent to, plans to send to NCPR.
Hey, Andrea?
Yes.
Mr. Clyde is back to answer a question if you need to do that real quick.
Okay.
Great, thank you. Mr. Albright, we have Mr. Sutton needs to leave the meeting. He has an appointment. He needs to leave the meeting at 11. And I wanted some feedback from you about whether or not we still have a quorum and a virtual meeting if we've convened the meeting and then one of the commissioners has to leave.
Yes, you still have a quorum with four members of the board.
Okay, I just wanted to verify that and be sure that Mr. Sutton can feel free to leave whenever he needs to. Okay? Great. I'm sorry, Andrea, go ahead.
So the budget amendment before you will adjust the accounting records for the grant fund to match what we're reporting to NCPRO. And additionally, it will budget funds in the county manager department so that we can keep all of the future January through June possible response efforts all budgeted in one line item, being able to keep track of that according to the list that Mr. Hagan shared with you earlier. We ask that you would approve this budget amendment today.
Commissioner Boswell, I move that we approve it.
Have we taken a vote on the last motion?
Yes, we did.
Oh, sorry.
You voted for it.
Okay. I got confused when we were asking a question about the quorum, I guess.
Yeah.
So Commissioner Mount Possible has made a motion to approve the budget amendment.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Commissioner Carter has seconded it. Is there any discussion or question? If not, I'll call the roll. Vice Chair Carter?
Yes.
Commissioner Boswell?
Yes.
Commissioner Lashley?
Yes.
Commissioner Sutton, you're still with us? Okay, Commissioner Sutton is not present. And I, Chair Gailey, vote in the affirmative as a yes. Mr. Albright, does that count as an affirmative vote for Mr. Sutton? He left the meeting, but I understand that when a commissioner abstains from a vote, unless it's excused, then they are counted as a yes vote.
Under the remote meeting rules, that rule doesn't apply. So your vote would be for approving. For voting to approve.
Okay. Thank you. So the motion carries 4-0 with Commissioner Sutton not voting. All right. Thank you very much. The next item on our agenda is the public speakers. I have the sign-up sheet from Monday night. We had 4 people who have provided telephone numbers, and the one person has provided written comments. Madam Clerk, have you been in contact with these 4 people who asked to be called and verified that they are going to be called today?
Yes, I was not able to get in touch with the first speaker. I had to leave a message, so if we want to try to call her. But the others, I was able to speak to.
Okay, great. If you could go ahead, the first person on the list is Melanie Mitchell. We're going to go through the 4 who we have phone numbers for, and then after we call the 4 of them, then we will read, or the clerk will read the written comment.
Forwarded to an automated voice messaging system.
Yeah.
No answer.
Okay, so we called the first number. That was, I don't know if I mentioned the person's name. That was Melanie Mitchell.
Correct.
Who had requested to be called for her public comment. And she did not answer. So the next person on the list is Clifton Carter. Thank you.
Mr. Carter?
Hello? Yes.
You're connected to the county commissioners meeting for your public comments.
Yes. I'm ready to state my comments.
Mr. Carter, can you hear me?
Can you hear Chair Gailey?
I can barely. It's broken up slightly.
Okay. You can start your comment whenever you're ready. There's 3 minutes.
Can you hear me clearly?
Can I hear you?
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
Okay. Well, I'll begin if you don't mind. to you who sit in the seat of power, the electorate, you, the architects of society, I pose two questions to you today. Who do you represent and what do you represent? I pose these questions because of the issues concerning the removal of the statue, which I refer to as the smokestack on the engine of racism. To help me illustrate what is happening in our county and at our country, allow me to use an analogy presented by two professors of history, Blaine Robertson and Ethan Kyle. Imagine when the World War II ended in 1945, if Germany would have spent decades erecting memorials to German soldiers and generals, political leaders, as well as the Nazi cause, despite losing the war. Imagine that this process started slowly but picked up steam between the 1970s and the 1990s, when hundreds of monuments would go up across Germany in town squares, on university campuses, at battlefields, despite losing the war. Imagine too that these memorials said nothing about the racist caste ideology of the Nazi Party, not to mention the Holocaust. Instead, they highlighted the bravery of the German troops and the nobility of their fight for the fatherland. Despite losing the war, that is, despite losing the war. Finally, imagining that this wave of Nazi memorialization coincided with the passage of laws that disenfranchised and discriminated against the Jews and set off a campaign of violence that killed on average 2 Jewish people a week for 3 decades, and that's after losing the war. How would Germans, who would today argue that they are simply tributes to fallen ancestors and they're nothing more than benign commemorations of the past? Reasonable people can agree on exactly what we would do with the Nazis' statues in this analogy. With that said, the one thing that we should agree on is that we cannot allow the Confederate statues to remain as they are. Just in case you didn't know it, Americans didn't just export trade items to Germany in the 1930s. We gave them the blueprints to our version. We gave them the blueprint to our scientific racism that they used it. Just research the name Lothrop Stoddard and you'll find out why. But somehow the Germans got it right. They outlawed the memorialization of people and policies that took their nation into a deep, dark era. They didn't forget it because we won't let them. However, this nation behaves exactly the opposite of how we know what is morally right and just. We fought to abolish in Europe, we support in our own country. The anger and frustration that is emitted from many of the citizens participating in our marches is because they know the full story of our nation's history, not just the sanitized version that's in our history book. I say to you, in the words of the Apostle Paul, a murderer and a proselytizer who preached hate and disdain for Jewish people, that same Paul, who was saved by grace and the mercy of our Almighty God, opened the gated minds of men, saying, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, and that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God." Can this miraculous transformation happen again? It needs to happen for all peoples here in our county. We, the constituency who support the statue remaining where it stands, argue that the statue is a tribute to their fallen ancestors of Alamance County who fought in the Civil War. The constituency who support the removal of the statue, I'll use the words of our ancestor Frederick Douglass. "Fellow citizens, I am not indifferent to the claims of generous forgetfulness but whatever else I may forget, I shall never forget the difference between those who fought for liberty and those who fought for slavery, between those who fought to save the Republic and those who fought to destroy it. That statue represents those who fought for slavery. And I will tell you that I represent the constituency that you commissioners do not acknowledge. And that's the African American, the indigenous people, the Jews, Latinx, LGBTQ, and those who are not included on the spectrum of white supremacy. I cannot and we will not accept the behavior of those who idolize oppression, inequality, and the maintenance of an American caste system. It cannot remain in place. And I finally close with, if the South had won the Civil War, do you think I would be able to stand or sit and address you today? I would like for you to just think that over. I think not. Statute 100.2.1 is just a knee on the neck of the common man here in Alamance County. And it needs to change. And you need to allow the people to see you take action to take that statue down. And that's pretty much all I have to say. I hope my words were clear, and I hope I was understood. And this is, that analogy was just that, but it's not hyperbole. It is exactly.
Mr. Carter.
Yes.
Mr. Carter, I'm gonna have to cut you off. Your 3 minutes expired like some time ago, and under the circumstances, especially arising from the confusion from Monday night, I really have tried to be as generous as possible in extending your time as long as I could. But in fairness to other speakers, I feel like at this time I have to ask you if you have one concluding sentence or something to wrap it up, then that would be appropriate.
I really appreciate the extra time, and I'm sorry for what happened on. Feel sorry for everyone for what happened on Monday on the last meeting, and I will accept the apology of Mr. Bill Young Lashley for the inappropriate comments that he made, and you can extend that apology for me. For him to say, for me to control my people, I thought was inappropriate, but I do accept his apology.
All right, thank you, Mr. Carter. We'll go on to the next person on the list. That's Quinslin Ellison.
Hello?
Miss Ellison? Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. You're connected to the county commissioners meeting for your public comments.
Okay, hi, and thank you for having me today. So I wanted to address each of you with starting off with some terms that came up when I looked up fascism. Political philosophy, movement, or regime that exalts nations and often race above the individual and that stands for a centralized government headed by a dictatorial leader. Also, some of the things that came up under fascism was supremacy of the nations and its leaders, Adolf Hitler, Holocaust. I get so confused at the term Antifa. I don't think it has a clear definition, and I'm not exactly sure what it is. I have listened to members of this board criticize our efforts for change in this community. Insults of the protest tactics have constantly been the response to our efforts. I have never attended an Antifa class. I have never damaged property and never physically attacked anyone. But what I have did is spend countless hours trying to find solutions to the growing problem of racism in this county and in this nation, along with several others and organizations. We are actively trying to figure out how this monument that is offensive to black and brown people can be moved to a safe location so it can be honored by those who believe it represents heritage, while also not offending those who feel it is a symbol of an oppressive history. All summer, I have been sitting on different boards and panels to address what is being ignored by the people in this room or on this Zoom call, the five commissioners that are represented here. Please take this opportunity to not insult people or accuse them of trying to make progress, but join us in the discussion to make progress in this county, to make sure everyone who lives here is represented accurately and effectively. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Allison. The next person who requested to be called is Katie Cassette.
That's correct.
Hello?
Ms. Cassette?
Yes.
Okay, you're connected to the county commissioner's meeting for your public comments.
Okay, do I begin right now?
Yes.
Okay. Hi, my name is Katie Cassette. I live in Graham. I want to ask that each of you put your frustration aside and just make some space for the enormous amount of anger that people in this town are feeling, especially the black community. It is tense here, and that statue brings a lot of attention. Those of us calling for its removal are not the outlandish ones. They are coming down all over the country. You are bullishly digging your heels in for a monument that will soon be just as out of style as a colors-only sign hanging from a water fountain. It's a fact that statue was erected by white supremacists. It's a fact that supporters of that statue regularly flash the white power sign. Interestingly, Terry Johnson says it's his sacred duty to protect it. I'll let you connect those dots. We have been aggressively arrested, snatched from sidewalks, slammed on the ground, women and men. My children were pepper sprayed. My 8-year-old doesn't want to be a police officer anymore. He's terrified of them now. We've been arrested for speaking, standing, dancing. Instead of listening, you try to silence us and arrest us even more. Change needs to come, reform needs to happen, but the first step is to acknowledge the problem. I'm here to inform you that Black Lives Matter is not a divisive statement or a symbol of hate. And in the words of Christopher LeBron, author and scholar, Black Lives Matter just represents a civic desire for equality and a human desire for respect. Will each of you say on the record today that Black Lives Matter? And do not say all lives matter. We know that. Obviously they do. But that is besides the point. By saying Black Lives Matter, you are not only stating a very simple and obvious fact, but you are also acknowledging that the black community has faced and continues to face incredible racial disparities that exist across the board in housing, education, healthcare, the wealth gap, criminal justice. Simply acknowledging that the black community's roots in this country began in oppression and slavery, where they were from the beginning seen not as human, but as property, controlled by horrendous fear and pain and by withholding education and resources. Acknowledge that this trauma can live in cells and be passed down through generations. Acknowledge mortgage discrimination. These are historical facts. acknowledge a history of voter suppression. Henry London, who erected the monument, proudly tried to suppress the black vote. Acknowledge the statistical fact that young, unarmed black men are 13 times more likely to die at the hands of the police. The unwillingness to name that black lives merely matter is preventing light and truth to shine into a deep wound, a wound that has been festering since this country was born. Will each of you proudly show the black community that resides in the county you swore to represent that black lives matter? Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, thanks, Ms. Cassette. The person who has submitted a written comment is Amy Jackson.
Okay. Vice Chair Carter opened your last meeting with a lovely prayer, seeking peace in our community, communication, sharing, and most importantly, caring. He asks God to give you the wisdom, encourage, and to guide your deliberations so that the actions you take would be acceptable in God's sight. He asks for mercy, grace, peace, comfort, and safety. I share that prayer for our community, that all of our community members can live in peace, comfort, and safety. And I would like to see you take the wise and caring step of really listening to your community members who have been telling you that they are unable to attain that peace due to the presence of the monument to white supremacy that continues to stand guard at the county courthouse. By ignoring and dismissing those voices, I believe the five of you are actively obstructing God from answering Mr. Carter's beautiful prayer. Commissioner Lashley dismissed the concerns of community members at your last meeting, saying that if we take that statue down, it's not going to help anybody's life. That statue should not make anybody's decision to feel good or bad. It's a piece of marble. If Mr. Lashley's statements are true, then why do you all fight so hard to keep that statue standing? And why do so many white community members show up with guns and threats of violence against peaceful protesters calling for its removal? Clearly, the reasoning is it's not economic. The county could earn needed income by selling the monument to someone who wants to set it up on private land. Even paying for its demolition is likely to cost less than its maintenance and protection during future decades. White people can choose to ignore the pain and suffering that a monument to white supremacy causes our neighbors because white people are not the targets of that hatred, but the beneficiaries of it. In fact, a 2019 study at UNC demonstrated that state laws protecting Confederate monuments, like the NC law Alamance County Commissioners are hiding behind, do not affect white people's feelings of belonging in the community at all. On the other hand, their research found that these laws directly affect black Southerners by making them feel like they do not belong. By telling your community that you don't think a racist monument's presence matters one way or the other, while paradoxically refusing to remove it, you are sending a very clear message that black Southerners don't belong in Alamance County. Is that what you intend? I agree with one of Mr. Lashley's sentiments. Removing a monument to white supremacy is not sufficient on its own to create safety and welcome. Dismantling white supremacy is a process that does not begin and end with the removal of a piece of marble. But our community members are saying clearly that a truth and reconciliation process must include the removal of the statue that honors those who fought and died to keep black Americans enslaved. And these are, again, from Amy Jackson.
All right. Thank you, Madam Clerk. That is all of the people that I had from the public comment sign-up sheet from Monday night. Was there anybody else? Did I miss anybody?
No, that's all we have received, Madam Chair.
Okay, thank you very much. So that's the end of the public speakers on non-agenda related items. Do we have any commissioner responses? Well, I will respond in part to Ms. Cassette. She mentioned acknowledging that there are problems with race in our country, and I would take this opportunity to do that and to acknowledge that African Americans in the course of the history of the United States have obviously been treated differently from the writing of the Constitution through, and you know, there was redlining in the 19 at one point with neighborhoods. There were racial disparities or discrimination in mortgage lending practices. Obviously, there was segregation in schools. And those effects do still linger quite clear in adverse health outcomes for African Americans. And there's a myriad of problems and challenges for the African American community that's related to the history of racial disparities in our country. So I have no problem acknowledging that.
Thank you, Amy. I agree with what you just said. The acknowledgement of a history of racist activity is unquestionable. And as I said, I think in our previous meeting, not this past Monday, but prior meeting, I don't believe that the gentleman and lady that are currently sitting at this board and that I've known for a long time have racist hearts, and I know the young men that are joining our board and lady, and their passion for Christ and their love of their neighbor, and I think they're also going to be people that we will see that don't have racist tendencies at all, and don't have racism in their hearts. And we want to try and find solutions to the issues that are coming up before us. And I hope that as we move forward, we can move forward hand in hand and come up with something that satisfies all the citizens of Alamance County. Thank you.
Anyone else? All right, I don't want to cut anybody off in the virtual format. Sometimes it's a little bumpy and moving forward. So it's not my intention to deprive anyone of their right to or opportunity to say what's on their mind. Mr. Hager, it sounds like we're ready for the county manager's report.
Thank you. The only thing I want the commissioner's attention is in the packet. You hopefully noticed a memo from me pertaining to Cocal Sandrock, a private landfill facility located at 5833 Foster Store Road. The folks there at Cocal Sandrock are planning to increase their shipping fee from $36 per ton to $38 per ton, and my memo says that will be effective January 1st. They've indicated to us that in order to stay compliant with their franchise agreement that requires 30 days notice be given to the commissioners and to the public, they'll make that effective January the 15th. So there's no action needed. Just they've done this in the past, and we always included the package so the public can see it. I wanted to be sure that the commissioners knew that the tip and fees and totals will be going up. And the other thing I would say is a big thank you to Bruce Walker, Scott Ward, Greg Slagle. This is kind of a historic meeting, I believe, to have everyone, all commissioners and most staff and guests virtual, and Bruce and his folks have pulled off a great meeting today and helped a lot of behind the scenes work coordinating different technologies to make this work. I certainly appreciate it. I'm sure the board does too. It's really good to have the IT resource to be able to go to and say, here's what we got to do. Can you make it work? And they did it every time. So thank you.
I agree. Thank you. Good team.
Yes, great job, Andrew. Yeah, it's been very successful. You'd asked me 12 years ago if I ever thought I'd do a commissioner meeting on the telephone. I said, what? But thanks to the tech crew right there in the room that will put this together. Thank you.
Well, I will say, Mr. Carter, you said it correctly. It's about a team, and my team, through the election and through all the different events that have been happening in this thing, they've really stepped up and over time they never said no and they found ways to do it. Scott's trying to get his next degree. He's got his testing. He came in during that time to help with this moment. So they really, I'll stand up here and say we have the best IT team in the state. And I'll stand by that any day of the week. So it's all them.
Yes, indeed, I'll echo that as well. Through this pandemic, IT departments across the board have had fresh challenges and been difficult in local government IT departments, particularly trying to coordinate the different types of technology for meetings such as this, but also keeping up the Department of Social Services, helping the court system, trying to work with the administrative office of the courts, and making sure that the courts have the resources that they need. It's really been a lot of complex challenges day after day after day for them. So thank you very much for all the work that you all do. Do we have any commissioner comments? I guess we kind of morphed into that already. Does anybody have any comments they want to offer today?
Chair Gailey, thank you for doing your job. You've done an excellent job working through this, and thank you for what you've done. And best of luck when you get to Raleigh. Hope you can move that bunch as good as you've done us, right?
That's very kind. Thank you. You're not so hard to move.
I would like to make one more comment. I believe in December we will be replacing Bill Ashley and Tim Sutton and Eddie Boswell with three new members, and I want to just acknowledge, and I may be stepping in somebody else's mess here. If I am, I apologize, but I've known these three guys for a long time and consider them really good friends. And I'm going to miss them. I'm going to miss their service to the community and their experience. The knowledge they bring to the board is irreplaceable, really. And they're going to be missed by all, I believe. And just thank them for their service.
Bill,
are
y'all planning to come to the meeting on the
6th?
Is that right?
Oh, yes. I plan to be there.
Okay.
And I want to say also that I want to thank the staff and the other commissioners for being part of a successful career. It's been a pleasure to serve the taxpayers of Alamance County, and I want to say thank you all.
That's great. I'm looking forward to loving up on you all. Thank you for all and saying some nice things. At that time. Let's see, is there anything else that I wanted to mention? I can't recall. Oh yeah, I did have something I wanted to mention. Mr. Boswell said nice things about me and my service, and I appreciate that very much, but I would be a horrible human being if I did not immediately point out that I have the best county manager in the state that I get to work with every day. So anything that you see me doing that's positive, it's got to be some kind of reflection off of the hard work that Brian does, and I appreciate him very much.
That's true.
Amen.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
I agree with that for sure.
Happy Olson.
Amen.
So y'all all agree that I wouldn't be that great if I didn't have a
Okay. You've been an excellent manager. You have been an excellent chair, and thank you so much.
So an excellent,
It's 11:35, and I think we're all ready for lunch, and we finished all the business on our agenda, so this meeting will be adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.